and powerlifting, and I was in champion in all of them. So on my 40th birthday in 1985, I decided to immigrate to Los Angeles to lay on the beach and drinking mojitos. It happened then that Arnold was shooting a movie in Los Angeles called Commando, and I have worked with Arnold out of Denmark on Conan the Barbarian in Spain. And I was invited up there, and the producer, Jude Silver, got so excited about my size. I was 142 kilograms. I had just in Denmark at the Danish Powerlifting Championships did a world record for masters, guys over 40 years old. I did 242 and a half kilograms. So he asked me if I would like to be in the movies and be around Arnold and helping, assisting, playing cowboys and Indians for $20,000. That was only a few things I had to do, be a member of Screen Actors Guild, have a social security number. So I fixed that. And when I wrote my book, Strong Men in Hollywood, a few years ago here, I realized that in 30 years in America, in Hollywood, I've done 160 productions in film and TV. So a year later, after I arrived, I got that call about the A-Team. And Greg Bagley, who was the stunt coordinator there, he hired me. And I played a part like Rolf. It's like the whole show is about the German scientist who have a nuclear device. He want to sell and escape from East Germany. And then the A-Team decides to go undercover and as a football team and challenge the German group of athletes in the exhibition contest for, you know, in American football. My participation was I was working for KGB, and I was, of course, on the Eastern European football team side, and there were some big fights and different stuff. What I recall the most was that on the day of the first day of shooting, Mr. T arrived in a red Rolls Royce with a Mickey Mouse hat on, and when he stepped out, he had a red sneaker shoe on his left foot and a white shoe on his right foot, and he didn't stop talking all day long. His mouth was going, and we were all like flabbergasted. At the same time, it was a pleasure to hang with Jim Brown, one of the football players, John Matusak, who's unfortunately dead now, and then, of course, Joe Namath, and also not to forget, what's his name, and then all top football players. And I was fitting in well because I was the biggest of them all, so we became good friends. You know, size, attract size. So when big guys meet other big guys, you know, we have something in common. And particularly Jim Brown, who's always challenging people when you see people bigger and then stronger than him. So he became a kind of an associate, where later on had the pleasure of working with him on Running Man, where he also had a job there as one of the gladiators.
And Sven, in terms of working with the A-Team, and you mentioned Mr. T there, and it's not many people that come onto the set in the the A-Team and that can match up to sort of T's presence. And dare I say, have T sort of looking up at them rather than the other way around. And was that sort of, did you sort of revel in that you were able to come on and maybe not have the looming presence of Mr. T sort of looking down at you?
No, he was just a very likable guy. And but he was like in his own little world, acting out with his gold chains around his neck. I mean, he fit the part perfectly. You know, I mean, he was extremely entertaining, extremely bright, and very nice. And there was no star acting out. You know, he was just one of the guys.
Yeah,
he was always a big. He was always a big guy, by the way. Yeah. Muscular and bloggy.
And Sven, you obviously mentioned this. You came from a background in Denmark and obviously with strongman and competitions like that. And you made your name for yourself. But even back when you were probably growing up in Denmark and sort of stuff, you would have probably known the worldwide star that George Peppard was, and he's Hollywood fame. And you probably might have even heard of Breakfast at Tiffany's with Audrey Hepburn back in Denmark, or your parents might have heard about it as well. So were you? Was there a sense of excitement? Was there a certain sense of nervous anticipation when you were going to be on a production with George Peppard in it? George Peppard was like James Gardner of the Rockford Files, this big, larger-than-life sort of, did I say, daunting sort of figure. And did you get to meet George?
Sure I did. But, you know, I'm like the Irishman. Nothing can impress a Dane. So I just I stayed myself, my ironical, my satirical way of being. You know, Danes and Irishmen have great sense of humor, a dry sense of humor. So I was light right away, no digging ass, trying to make out in front of the guys. I was just one of the guys. Yeah. Like you guys, you know, nothing can impress you. I mean, if in Hollywood people see a person has been in a movie, they go nuts.
Yeah.
In Denmark, you go shopping and your Queen Margaret is shopping beside you and you're just polite, you don't go nuts. It's just, we are down-to-earth Danes and Irishmen.
Yeah, that's so true with us Irish as well. We the soul celebrity thing doesn't seem to faze us when someone is around in terms of that sort of status. We don't get paparazzi sort of struck in terms of that. No. But Sven, in terms of the A-team, and you mentioned that machismo and that sort of guy feel and that sort of that testosterone driven. And obviously you're appearing in a fun episode in season 5 with Jim Brown there, you said, Joe Namath, amongst others. I imagine in between takes, there was an awful lot of fun, a lot of giggles, an awful lot of crack. Because a shooting American football match, an exhibition match, is probably one of those sort of exciting concepts to start to shoot, because the choreography, the stunts, I imagine, is an awful lot of fun where there's no sort of ammunition or military training, or you're having speeding vehicles. You're just getting to mess around with a few guys on the field.
Yeah, but you see, when we play soccer in Ireland and we play soccer in Denmark, we sweat and we run all the time. But American football, I remember in Los Angeles, some years later, my lawyer, Keith Berglund, he was training rich kids football. And some of the kids there were Arnold Schwarzenegger's kids.
Yeah.
And so Arnold said to me when we were watching the kids playing, he's saying, Sven, do you understand American football? I said, no. And he said, but can't you see, they don't sweat, they never run. You know, so because there's so many breaks, it's a brutal sport, you know, they hit each other hard, but then you never see them sweat. Where a Danish football game or Irish football game, they run, we run all the time. And it's in that sense more physical. Mm. It's not that, body slamming, but you move all the time. So, I mean, I was not impressed. I was impressed by their size and they could take hard hits. But it was like then stopped all the time. And, it was just a game I never still understand.
And Sven, obviously, there's so many characters in the A-team, but one of the guys who was came from a great theatre background, a fantastic improv actor, obviously he played the scene of going nuts bananas in terms of set most of the times with Dwight Schultz, and very sophisticated, very intelligent man. How did you find your conversations with Dwight? Because everyone I spoke to speaking about Dwight Schultz has always had great things about Dwight to say, and he said that he could make a friend if he was a needle in a haystack, he'd find 1,000 other needles to make friends with. He's just a guy that seemed everyone seems to have liked. Was that your only experience with Dwight?
Extremely likable, you know, loved to tell stories, and you know, I mean, I just had a good time there, not feeling out of place. And also, you know, even though the business in those days was still kind of new for me, only been in town for maybe 12, 13 months, there was right away some camaraderie, and you're like a big family. Later on, when I worked on big pictures and other TV shows, every time you work on a show like that for a week or two or three or four or five, or up to 3-4 months, it's like family. Everybody is on a team. Everybody is being used the proper way, and nobody have as you hear about, you know, singing at themselves as stars. It's just a job like any other job in a sense, little unusual, but everybody is quite professional. A lot of pieces you see very often, some of the big stars are reading their lines behind camera to help maybe a newer, younger actor performing in front of the camera. You know, there's a team effort. And a team was an effort of everybody on the team.
Okay. And Sven, you probably got to work in many productions, as you said, when you arrived there in the 80s and 90s, throughout the States, and especially through California. Did you ever get to work on any Stephen Cannell productions afterwards, after the A-Team? And did you get to meet Stephen or cross paths with Stephen?
I met him once. And I think, I can't recall, there was another TV show, I think I forgot that... sure was that I can't recall now, but I worked on a lot of those TV shows. One of the fun experiences was one day I was driving my Jeep on PCA Pacific Coast Highway and saw a sign saying Baywatch.
Okay.
So I drove down and stopped in front of David Hasselhoff and said, Hey David, can I ask you a question? He said, yes. What is the question? Why don't you work on your show? So he said, well, are you an actor? Well, yeah, I'm an actor on the stuntman. So I did 4 episodes on that show. I mean, Hollywood was kind to me. And A-Team was one of the first things I did. I still keep and get residuals from that. And every time I see one of those checks, I have good memories from that.
And Sven, in terms of what's life like for Sven Thorsen now, is it a bit of R&R before a while it started downtime with the industry? And are you still actively involved, or are you pursuing other passions or getting back to your first love in terms of that? What's the whole world entailing for Sven Thorsen now in 2023?
Yeah, I'm an author. I'm a screenwriter. My wife is an author as well. She's a poet. She writes poetry books and books for children. I'm a screenwriter and an author myself. And over the years, I've been working together with several screenwriters. Amongst one is Dennis Hagen, who wrote Bronco Billy for Clint Eastwood, which I also worked with on Pink Cadillac a few years back. And that particular show is now becoming a musical. I'm going to premiere next year in London, the Bronco Billy musical, yeah. So my day is busy with interviews like this, newspaper interviews for Europe, for the world. But then writing is a big thing in my life, and reading. I'm just getting close to 80. But I'm still fit for fight and still hungry for new experiences and more knowledge, because knowledge is power for me. And I used to say and preach, my best friend is my discipline. And all these years, you know, working in the movie business, getting up 2 o'clock in the morning or work to 4 o'clock in the morning, any different places in the world, never felt like a job. It was like playing cowboys and Indians, and they get paid for it. So 160 productions in 30 years. I came to LA or to California to lay on the beach, but I happened to be so busy, there was no time to breathe. But I never felt I worked. It was fun being with the guys, doing great stuff, have great experiences, seeing the world. And then later in life, I've seen the world now, appreciating coming back to where I'm born. You know, I lived when I was 40, and I've been away for 35 years or so. And now being back, it's like, I'm a Dane. I'm born here, and I still speak Danish, and everybody's saying to me, they can't believe you've been 35 years away, and you still speak Danish. They say, but I'm a Dane. What are you talking about? So, I'm enjoying myself, and I have great, great, great memories. And when I do my seminars, I still come up with stories I have forgotten when people ask questions. I have a lot of stories to tell, a lot of war stories. And I was so fortunate some years ago, I did a big article for LA Times where they talked to me like I was a legend with great war stories. And I have a lot of stories to tell because I'm curious. There's a lot of time on the movie set where you don't work. So then you're behind the camera, and I always showed interest in the makeup department, the wardrobe department, the camera department, et cetera, you know. I'm still a happy guy.
And Sven, the final question to you now, and it's two sentence answer for you. It's what we ask everyone. If you had to sum up your experience appearing on the A-Team Season 5 Quarterback Sneak, which aired on October the 17th, 1986, where you played Rolf, if you had to summarize from the time you arrived on set to the time you said your goodbyes and departed that episode of the A-Team, what would you like your two sentences to read of your experience of your A-Team? Two sentences to summarize Sven Thorsen's experience on the A-Team.
Yeah. No, I can only say the A-Team was the A-Team.
The A-Team was the A-Team. One sentence to sum it up in perfection. Sven Ole Thorsen, Sven Thorsen, thanks for joining us this evening to share your experiences appearing on the A-Team Season 5, Episode 4, Quarterback Seek, starring alongside the one and only Jim Brown, Joe Namath as guest stars, and then obviously the regular cast and himself. Sven, for me, Jim Conlan, to you, enjoy a wonderful Denmark. Stay safe. Take care. God bless. Do enjoy the reading and writing, and please, God, we'll speak to you sometime again in the near future. But for the moment, Sven, take care and God bless, sir.
Love and peace to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Sven.